Crescent City Steakhouse, a true neighborhood restaurant operated by the Vojkovich family since 1934, is the oldest steakhouse in the city of New Orleans. Serving only hand-cut, prime-age, corn-fed beef for over 80 years, Crescent City Steakhouse has become a dining destination for both diehard locals and adventurous travelers who seek traditional, timeless New Orleans cuisine. Crescent City Steakhouse, 1001 North Broad, on the corner of St. Philip, in the heart of New Orleans.
Fall in love with autumn with PJ's new seasonal lattes. Our pumpkin latte brings you all the flavors of a pumpkin pie with hints of cinnamon and nutmeg, like your favorite holiday dessert in a cup. And our s'mores latte with flavors of toasted marshmallows, warm milk chocolate, and graham cracker cinnamon is sure to bring back campfire memories. The PJ's Fall Seasonal Lattes, available at your local PJ's only for a limited time.
Of palmetto cheese.
Good evening and welcome to Primetime Sports. Hey, I'm your host Scott Alexander, and what a great day this is. 56 years ago today, the Saints got awarded the franchise, November 1st, 1966. And boy, what a great week it is to be a Saints fan and sports fan in general in the Crescent City, because the Saints finally played the kind of football we've been expecting all season. That guy right there, Alvin Kamara, they put the ball in his hand a bunch. He had 9 catches, almost 100 yards there in receiving, 2 touchdowns receiving, and another one rushing. The defense played lights out, putting a shutout in one of the highest scoring teams in the league from last season, the Las Vegas Raiders. So look, they're 3-5, not great, but they're still only a game behind the Atlanta Falcons for first place in the South. So don't give up on this team. They still got time to make this happen. How about the LSU Tigers? They got Alabama this weekend, and it feels like the old times when they used to get up for Alabama, because now people think they might have a chance to win. The last couple of years, not so much. But this team right here, this team is a 13-point underdog thanks to 2 big victories. They beat Ole Miss, who was ranked 7th at the time, 45-20, and then Florida the week before. So this team can score in points. Look out for a shootout in this game on Saturday night in Tiger Stadium under the lights. You know, crazy things can happen. And how about the Tulane Green Wave? I cannot leave Willie Fritz's club out. This team is rolling. 7-1 right now, ranked 19th in one poll, 21st in the other, right below LSU. And they go to play University of Central Florida. This is going to be a huge game. They need your support as well, and the New Orleans Pelicans. What a great time to be a sports fan in New Orleans. This team is starting off like we thought they would, 4-2, unlike last year where it was 1-11. This team is exciting, and they beat up on the Clippers a couple days ago, and then they get the Los Angeles Lakers. They get to beat up on AD tomorrow night. Hey, how about also the World Series? It got rained out last night, but it's back in Philly, and it's an exciting one. The Astros dropped game 1 against the Phillies when they were down up 5-0, and they came back and won in game 2 after losing that one 6-5 in the first one. So the World Series is going to be fun. And also, don't forget, we have a great show for you. Tasman Mitchell, 2006 Final Four player. He's a coach with LSU right now. He is a great person. And Tom Brady, our friend's going to join him and talk about that great 2006 team. But we're going to have a surprise for you, because I have another guest that's going to talk Saints, Pels, LSU, and of course Tulane coming up next right here on Primetime Sports.
Sundays at 6:30 p.m.
Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sports. We know it's football season. It's right in the middle of it. The LSU Tigers are rolling. It's Alabama week. The Saints finally got that elusive win. They shut out the Raiders, as we talked about in the open. Tulane is rolling in the top 20 as well. It's great, but it's also basketball season. You know, it's my favorite sport. The Pelicans are now 4-2. How about that? They got the Lakers tomorrow. It's going to be fun, but the LSU Tigers. That's right. They have a new coach, a new regime, and a bunch of new players. But they have the same old guy that's been there for quite a while. He was a four-time All-State player from Denham Springs, four-time first-team All-State. Think about that. Number one player in the country coming out of high school. Could have gone anywhere in the country. But he decided to stay in his hometown. He's from Denham, Baton Rouge around the corner, and played for the LSU Tigers and our boy John Brady. And here he is once again. He was on the show about three, 4 years ago. What's up, Taz Mitchell?
What's up, man?
How you doing, man?
Thank you for having me.
Man, we go way back, dude.
Super.
Like, when you're like ninth or tenth grade, you're one of these guys, kind of like LeBron, that we all knew who you were when you were like eighth, ninth grade.
Yes,
like,
sir.
Really, there's not only a few of y'all. Sebastian Telfair was one of these dudes. You know, like Tracy McGrady kind of came out of nowhere his senior year. Mm-hmm. But we knew who you were, man. What was it like being a phenom growing up?
Oh, man, it was great. You know, I soaked all that in, but I stayed humble, man. You
100%.
Know, I mean, my mom and my grandmother always stay humble and hungry, you know, so I stayed humble, but I was liking it. So that just let me know that my hard work was paying off.
You've always been that humble guy. And I'll tell you what, your mom did a great job. Is that the influence that gave you that? Because, I mean, listen, we all knew, like I said, who you were, but every time I interviewed you, I mean, I probably started talking to you about 10th or 11th grade. I was like, this guy's grounded. Where'd you get that from?
My mom, man, and my grandmother, but my mom most of all.
Right.
Man, I saw how hard she was working, single parent.
Right.
She worked, you know what I'm saying? She worked hard for me, you know what I'm saying? I'm an only child.
Uh-huh.
So she made sure that I was doing the right thing. I was in my books, man, and I was taking my education serious. You know, like I was telling a lot of people, man, I got perfect attendance in school.
That's great.
Until I was like a senior in high school. I had to miss for a tournament. I had to miss it for basketball. She did not want to let me miss, but I had
missing.
To. Yeah.
You ain't missing but, until your senior year. That's crazy.
But yeah, that's where it comes from, man. I saw my mom work hard, man. She always instilled in me stay in church, you know, be in church. Even if she had to work, she sent me with my grandmother, and I just learned from them, man. You know, the village raised me. You know, my mom, my grandmother, my aunts.
Gotta have the village.
Got to, man. Got to.
I remember the first time I saw you was in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. It was Bob Gibbons' tournament.
Yes,
you know, that tournament's kind of where I met some other, the New Orleans Jazz AU team. Before you, there was like Jonathan Bender. There he is. That's right. Your Jazz. That's at the Dean Dome right there. We had guys like Chris Duhon, you know, who ended up going to Duke. Mo Williams ended up going to, obviously, Alabama. But then your regime came in, Brandon Bass. You know, you, Big Baby, Garrett Temple.
Yeah.
I mean, you had some ballers on that squad. But talk about that, man, because when you're coming up and you're playing with these guys that are all – right. Going to be future stars. I mean, what was that like being with that group?
Oh, man, it was great, man. It was an honor because, you know, I'm from Denham Springs.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I was by myself in Denham Springs.
Sure.
But we used to go to Baton Rouge and play against Big Baby and them since I was 10.
Right,
and
Garrett right.
since I was 11. Then Brandon was always a little older than us, so
yeah.
I never really played against him.
Yeah.
But, you know, I wanted to play with him, but he ended up leaving before I left out. But we just somebody, Brandon was somebody we always looked up to, you know, growing
sure.
up. Like,
sure.
I used to go to the EBR tournament
yeah.
when I, you know, Denham Springs didn't play in it, so I used to go watch him play and stuff like that. It was great, you know, I felt like them guys were my brothers, man. So that's why our team chemistry, that's where it kind of led to that, you know, to that situation in which we were all friends. So I just decided to, I'm gonna stay home, man.
And I got a surprise because John Brady's gonna come. We're gonna talk about that great 2016 because I haven't really done that with you and him together. It's gonna be fun. But I want to talk about it a little bit before. I even flew you to Atlanta. Wait, but
yes.
this what year would this
my
be?
First, like, you was my first interview. You was my first TV interview.
Are you serious?
I was nervous. I was like, okay, yeah, you. That's Fox. You was with Fox. I think you somewhere else.
Fox Sports.
Yeah,
Fox Sports South. Right. I mean, we had. But and then I remember I became an agent. And I remember going down to Doc Wampole's house, and we sat you down. I had Pat Dye Jr. I mean, I'm thinking we definitely go way back.
Yeah, we definitely go way back, man. We got a lot of the great mutual friends, man, and Dr. Richard Wampole.
And you know, Julie, so the of best, course. The We'd best. Be remiss not to mention Julie.
And Miss Julie, but Dr. Wampole, the best dentist in Baton Rouge, man. I love him to death, man.
He's still like my father. Even when I was in Atlanta, I still went up there. Shoot, 8 hours. But going forward, when you were playing at LSU, man, listen, you had that great freshman year. I mean, you got to the Final Four. I mean, it's kind of crazy. But you were the dude that could have gone pretty much any time, and you end up staying. You're the top five literally in almost every category, which is kind of crazy when you look at this. You know, everybody knows Pistol Pete, everybody knows Shaq. You know, Bob Pettit was the best small forward in NBA history until guys like Barkley and Tim Duncan came around.
Right.
And then Chris Jackson, to me, is the most electric player I've ever seen.
Right.
But you're sitting there right there, right there, 1, 2, 3, 4, in all these different categories, that's got to mean something, huh?
Oh, it means a lot, man. It means a lot for my legacy. Yeah. And, you know, my kids can mean a lot for my kids as well. You know, they can see, hey, man, you know, your dad was this, your dad was that. So that's the most amazing thing about it right now, the legacy that I'm going to leave for my children, right. You know.
And you loved being a student, didn't you? Because, I just remember, like, you always had a smile on your face. I would go up to them games. I mean, people loved you on campus.
Well, you know, my mom played a lot for these teeth, man. You know, I had to so I had to show them.
Nah, but discount.
But nah. But yeah, man. You know, I felt like if I was in school, I had to go to school. You know what I'm saying? You had got to go in there. So that's why I was able to get my degree. The years that I stayed at LSU, I got my degree as well. So I'm thankful for staying 4 years. I'm thankful for staying my years at LSU.
How was it like when that freshman year, when y'all going to the Final Four? It's not like now, everybody's online, half the classes, and you walking through the quad. I went to LSU myself.
Yeah.
And you just like, you know, everybody's loving you. That's got to feel good.
It was great. It was actually one of the times that we couldn't wait to get back to school.
Right, let's go.
Everybody was up with their clothes, their book sacks on. Hey, man, we're going to school. We're going to sit in the quad. So we got all the rah, rah, rah. But then, you know, one thing about LSU, man, it's the greatest thing about LSU is the fans, is the people. So they really embraced us, man, and made us, you know, I felt like we did it for the city. I felt like we did it for the state because that's the year Hurricane Katrina came.
So it was
everything just worked out, man. I had a lot of people tell me in the grocery store, man, hey, man, from New Orleans, hey, man, you're making us smile, man. You keep putting a smile on our faces, you know what I'm saying? In the city of gloom, we was putting smile and happiness and people's hearts, man. And so it was real special for us.
You started right when Hurricane Katrina, because you graduated high school in 05.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, Katrina was end of August in 05 as well.
Yes.
But what was that like? Because I remember Les Miles, that was his first year there.
Right.
You know, he had that big win. He had to go on the road to Arizona State instead of playing home. They had this crazy win. But as a student going to LSU, I know you lived not far away, but what was that like having to deal with that, though?
Oh, man, it was, that year, it was real sorrowful, you know what I'm saying, especially what happened in the city, you know what I'm saying, because the city of Baton Rouge and New Orleans, you know, we're one, and I felt like we felt, you know what I'm saying, like I said, we didn't know what they were going through because we wasn't actually in it, but our hearts and our prayers went out to them, so any way we could have helped them out, we helped them out, you know, like I said, that year, they turned the PMAC into part of Charity Hospital.
That's right, that was big, I remember that.
And, you know, we all volunteered, you know what I'm saying, me, Big Baby, Garrett, everybody, Darren Mitchell, everybody, we all volunteered and that helped them out and stuff like that during that time, you know, even guys that came down and they got off the bus at the PMAC, you know, we had old clothes and we wanted to just give it to them, you know what I'm saying, that like it was a devastating time, so that also added more fuel to our fire to be successful on the basketball court with one another.
Darryl Mitchell was obviously a senior, I believe, when you were a freshman. You know, everybody's made we're going to talk about this when Brady comes on the set, but everybody's made a point that's the craziest year, because all you guys, you dealt with Katrina when you were a freshman. I think Garrett was probably a redshirt freshman. But
yes, sir.
Yeah, those guys, obviously Lazar, all you guys are from Baton Rouge, Denham, St. Martinville, within like 50, 60 miles, right? I don't think that's ever happened before, and I don't think it ever can happen again. Your top six players, all from right there, and you go to the Final Four.
Man, that's tough, man. I mean, and that's why I said, we're trying to get Coach Brady to get somebody to do a documentary on us.
Yes.
Because you know, I'm not saying a lot of teams go to the Final Four. A lot of teams go to the Final Four, and I get real passionate when I'm talking about this because, you know, we did it with brothers. We did it with people that we grew up together. We spent the night with one another. You know what I'm saying? I played with the Sports Academy Cubs as well. We all, me, Garrett, Tyrus, all of us, we all in the room just camping out. You know what I'm saying? Getting up, ready to get up in the morning for AAU game. So it was crazy. That's why our chemistry that's how it developed. And Brandon was, I mean, and what Brandon had left.
Yeah,
he had just left. And then we had also had Darnell Lazar that was there from Baton Rouge. He was our sixth man off the bench.
Right.
So the core, you know what I'm saying? I mean, not knocking none of the other guys that also helped us along the way, like Magnum Roll, Chris Johnson, Alex Farr, Ben Voog.
A lot of great,
you know what I'm saying, guys like that, you know what I'm saying? But we did it with the core, our core scores and our core guys that played the maximum amount of minutes.
Was the guy from
Baton Rouge, from the core. I'm not taking the Final Four away from each team, but I don't think nobody ever did it with guys from that city.
Well, you happen to be sitting in a building that's won a lot of awards for documentaries. This is the place right here. And I happen to work at Fox. I used to do a lot. So, Brady, we'll talk to you later about that because I'm passionate about that team.
Coach Brady.
But the crazy thing that I knew because I had to think about it. You've been with five LSU coaches. I mean, just think about this. You played for Brady. You played for Trent at the end.
Right.
He took that team in one of the greatest teams of LSU history. People don't even talk about that 09 team, right?
Yeah, you're right.
They're 14-2 or 16-2 in conference.
Yes,
they won the SEC. Marcus Thornton and you were the leads. I remember interviewing there. I remember being in the press conference, the SEC tournament, and interviewing y'all from the just asking questions from the crowd.
Right.
I remember like yesterday. I remember exactly where it was, but. You play for those two coaches, and then you coach under Johnny, right? Johnny Jones?
No. I missed Johnny.
You missed Johnny.
Yeah, I missed Johnny.
Okay.
I was in Europe playing my professional.
So
yes,
four
sir.
Still, but then
four
you had
sir.
Will Wade,
yes,
and now with Matt McMahon.
Yes, sir.
There's nobody more LSU than Taz Mitchell.
Oh, man.
Think about this. You played and coached all these dudes.
I would like to think so, man. Like I said, I love my university, man.
Yeah.
You know, I love my university. Everything they poured into me, and I just be wanting to pour it back by my knowledge and just giving back to them, you know.
Let's talk about this team. Because we're going to get more fun with Brady when we talk about that 2016. But this team right here that you're coaching, LSU, this is crazy. Matt got the job. You basically had almost no players.
Right.
He hired you, right? I mean, he kept you on.
Yes, sir.
And then y'all got, like, the entire team within 50 days.
Right.
How did that happen?
Oh, man, you know.
And a good team. These are good players.
First off, I'm thankful for Coach Matt, you know what I'm saying, who allowed me to stay on with him and as well as his staff. And I appreciate him for that, every day, you know, because he could have got rid of me, he could have got rid of me like he got rid
How'd
of everybody
that go?
Else.
How was the process? How is it where I'm sure somebody in the program was like, you probably should keep Taz around because everybody likes him. He knows a lot of people. But how did he first approach you?
Oh, man, he approached me, man. I just showed up for work every day until he told me, either he was going to tell me, hey, he sat down, he said, hey, I appreciate you for being here and helping me out throughout this process, because like I said, he just got off the plane, you know what I'm saying? So he didn't know a lot of things. So I was just there for him, and he said, I would like to keep you on if you okay with that. I said, I'm awesome with that. I am ecstatic with that. So basically that's how it went down.
And then Casey Long, right there, he played with you.
Yeah, Casey
AAU was my point. Right there. I remember he was on that Jazz team too, right?
Yeah, Casey was my point guard. Casey used to pass me the ball a lot.
I
appreciate it. I appreciate Casey for that.
Casey, I'll be over here on the wing. Pass me the ball.
Just pass the rock.
Okay, let's talk about this team, though. You got one guy that didn't get to play last year that Will had brought from Illinois,
right.
Adam Miller. And I'm just starting there because that's one guy I know, and I remember seeing him in Illinois.
Right.
What is this guy? He stayed, which is unusual because he got recruited by Will.
Right.
And he could have gone anywhere, right? And then because of the transfer portal, you can go and play the next year. But what makes him good, and why did he stay to play for Coach McMahon?
Well, I'm gonna go back to the point where why he stayed to play with Coach McMahon. Coach McMahon is a great coach, on and off the floor. He cares about his players,
right.
And he showed that to Adam.
Did he?
He showed it to Adam without bothering him. He just showed his commitment to, I want you on my team.
Wow.
Give me a chance to coach you.
Wow.
And then with his track record with guards like the Ja Morant and the campaigns and the other guys that he developed,
Ja Morant's pretty darn good.
He's pretty good. But it just speaks volume of what kind of guy Coach Matt is.
Yeah.
A genuine guy. You know what I'm saying? And he exuded that. He didn't sell no dreams. And he just told him that, he's going to give him his all in coaching him. And like I say, Adam was doing his rehab down here, and he got a real good relationship with our trainer, Sean Eddy, which is the best. He's the best.
I love that you said genuine, because that's the first thing I thought of.
He's
the first guy I've ever had on the show ever that I've never talked to before. Like, I got set it up. John Brady helped me get that, and then I'm dealing with the people in the personnel, Kent and everybody else. But it's weird because I usually know people pretty well before,
right.
And at least I've talked to him on the phone. Like, I had never talked to him once. There he is with the great Bob Pettit.
He's awesome, man. Coach Matt, from day one, he's a family man.
Yeah, he is.
And anybody that's about his family, man, is gonna treat his staff and his people.
You can tell that immediately. You know that?
He's a real family man. He has work-life balance. But
he
works hard.
He
works hard. And so it don't matter what time he goes on, but it's a work-life balance with him, So, anybody that's like that, you want to work for.
Absolutely.
Know what I'm saying? So I'm just thankful and I'm grateful and I'm blessed to also still be here with him.
Well, that speaks volumes because these three best players from Murray, who had a nice run, they've had a few nice runs in the tournament, but they had one of the best games in the tournament, beating San Francisco. You were probably getting ready for your own game, but That was an overtime game before they had that second round game against, I think, South St. Peter's or whatever.
Right.
But point being is that talk about the three guys that are coming. I mean, because these guys looked incredible. I know they were big-time players before. One went to South Carolina, one went to Arkansas. Right. But Juice Hill, K.J. Williams, who's already – he's the OVC player of the year, but he's right. already the second team All-SEC in preseason.
Right.
And, of course – is it Hannibal?
Trey Hannibal.
Talk about those guys, and are they going to start? I mean, is he's bringing three starters in, or how's this going to work with them?
Well, right now with Coach Matt, it's all an even playing field right now. You know what I'm saying? We really have no starters. How you practice is how you're going to start the game. You know what I'm saying? So basically, we're teaching habits.
Yes.
And like I said, he hadn't set out no starting five yet. He has an idea.
Yeah.
But he has not. Nobody's really set in stone. But Juice Hill, he's great point guard. We call him Juice. Bring the juice. You know what
bring
I'm saying?
The juice,
and he's fast. You know what I'm saying? He's fast. He's dynamic. He's athletic. You know what I'm saying? He's a floor general.
Yeah,
he gets everybody involved. He can shoot the ball. You know, I think he's a great asset to our team, and he's doing a great job leading our team.
Who are some of the other guys that, like, I know you got a guy from DeMatha that's a great player.
Tyrell Ward, top 25 player out of DeMatha, out of D.C.
I mean, to come in that late and get somebody like that's incredible to me.
Oh, man, it's great. Like I say again, it speaks volume of
who
your
he
coach,
is.
Who coach is. You know, these guys actually trusted us. It took us 50 days to get this roster together.
Did you go up there and talk to them?
No. That was Coach and one of our assistants, one of our great assistants that we got from Kermit, Ronnie Hamilton.
Nice.
Which is great.
Kermit Davis, John Brady's good buddy, coached at LSU as well.
Yeah, Kermit Davis, and he's a great asset to our staff as well. I'm learning a lot under him as well. So, like I said, I'm just a sponge right now, man.
That's
I'm
it.
Just soaking in all.
This is perfect for you.
This is perfect for me. This is a perfect situation.
This is kind of like going to graduate school.
Yes.
And one day you're going to get that opportunity.
But I learned from, but I like the core that I'm learning from right now. You know what I'm saying?
No
like
kidding, man.
Like Matt, Ronnie, you know what I'm saying? And even one of our old coaches, Kevin Nickelberry, you know what I'm saying? He taught me how to be on the recruiting side. You know
nice.
What I'm saying? So like I said, I'm just a sponge, man. I'm not too much to learn. So I want to learn something every day. Man.
I got a question for you on that. Because as a guy that was highly recruited, mm-hmm. I mean, Kentucky wanted you, everybody wanted you. What's it like to go out and be on the other side of that? And I don't know how far along you are in the recruiting world, but what's that like going out and trying to convince other stars to be what you were 20 years ago?
It's different, man. It's different because times have changed. You know what I'm saying? Times have changed so much. You know what I'm saying? Now you got the social media realm now that kind of stops people from recruiting. From what you can say about recruiting, because the people want to look to social media before they look to what you're saying.
Oh, yeah, dude.
First off, you know what I'm saying? But me, and then being an LSU man in the school that I love, I can talk with them with passion. I can actually talk about it. I can actually know about it. So that's why it's a great thing that so when I go in there and talk to them, I talk to them from the heart.
From the heart, all
the time. I mean, it's genuine.
And they know immediately.
They know immediately how passionate I am. Now, whether I get them or not is up to them.
Sure.
But as long as I know, I put my heart and my passion down for LSU.
That's like when I was recruiting you as an agent. I gave you my heart. It didn't work.
Hey, like one day about this industry, man, you get more no's than you get yeses.
No question about it.
So I'm learning that as well.
Almost every industry, actually.
Right.
Hey, you know, since John Brady's coming on, he's got a bunch of these shirts. I'm going to give you two because I think you need both these colors. They're great. This is Task Performance. You got one of these last time.
Yes, sir. I got a navy blue one the last time. I still wear it soft.
The softest ever, right?
Oh, man, it's best. Great quality.
The softest ever.
Great quality, man.
And when you come down New Orleans is a great restaurant uptown called Chez de la Chez.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.
Bring a friend, bring a significant other, bring somebody. But we're going to keep you here. And by the way, you know, this little regime you have at LSU, the basketball group, is really strong, but you still got that one weakness in the broadcasting booth. Chris Blair's doing a good job with that other guy. What's Brady like in the booth over there?
Hey, I'll tell you what. let me tell you what, man. Coach Brady is one of the best.
There's no doubt.
And probably I'm biased toward him because he coached me and played me a lot of minutes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? We won a great deal together, you know what I'm saying? But he's good, man. He's great.
I don't get to listen to him,
but before the games, I go over there and pick his brain, like, what you think, man?
Nice.
You know, what you think? He tell
nice.
Me what he thinks, and I listen to him, and I kind of reiterate it to my players as I'm talking to them, like, hey, watch this player, because, you know, Coach Brady, he got his nose down, he, you know, stuff like that. So I'm like, Coach, what you think? and he tell me what he think, and then I kind of am like, okay.
Well, I was kidding on air. He's great on air. Grab that ball for me, because this is a ball, like this ball here, this ball has got like Karl Malone. I mean, it's got tons of NBA players on it, but right. This one's got one name on it. And I'm going to add John Brady and you to this one because it's Dale Brown, and I've had it for a while now. Like, Dale gave me this a long time ago, but I said, you know what? I saw it in my house today, and I said, I want Taz on this ball. You're one of the legends, and we do this here, sign that ball. We're
going to
stick
you
around. But we're going to come right back. That's Taz Mitchell. Hey, we had a little surprise for him. He didn't know John Brady was coming. And quite frankly, until last night, I didn't either. We said, John, why don't we surprise Taz and have some fun? And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about that great 06 team, one of the great LSU teams of all time. There's only been three that have gone to the Final Four, at least since I've been alive. And I was in college for two of them, and this is the third one. This is my favorite team that LSU has ever had. We're coming right back with that on Primetime Sports.
The owners of the Delachaise Wine Bar on St. Charles Avenue have opened up their newest creation uptown on Maple Street called Chez Delachaise, a new local wine bistro featuring a larger menu of small and large plates, a brighter atmosphere, and full table service. Additionally, patrons can enjoy a large patio out front as well as an extensive wine list offering selections from around the world. It's Chez Delachaise, 7708 Maple Street between Carrollton and Broadway.
Fall in love with autumn with PJ's new seasonal lattes. Our pumpkin latte brings you all the flavors of a pumpkin pie with hints of cinnamon and nutmeg, like your favorite holiday dessert in a cup. And our s'mores latte with flavors of toasted marshmallows, warm milk chocolate, and graham cracker cinnamon is sure to bring back campfire memories. The PJ's Fall Seasonal Lattes, available at your local PJ's only for a limited time.
Positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative, but don't
Gold
miss
mine.
With Mr.
701 Dauphine Street in New Orleans.
Got to spread joy up to the maximum and bring gloom down.
Two minutes.
Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sports. Hey, like I said, we're going to get to the Saints, LSU Tigers, Tulane football, and even the Pels in my next segment. But right here, we're going to talk about this great year, 2006. LSU had a Final Four appearance in 81, another one in 86 when I was in college, 20 years later, with a team that was a little bit of a surprise. This is the only year that they had no number one seeds go to the Final Four, at least for since the era when they started the 64 teams. But this team did it with Florida. George Mason was an 11 seed. Florida was a 3 seed. LSU was a 4. And then UCLA was a 2. But, man, what a ride it was. You had guys that were all within 50, 60 miles of each other. And a lot of them were from Baton Rouge area. And then you had a couple down by the Bayou area with Darryl Mitchell and them. But we're going to talk about that team and how it came together. And then the progression all the way to the Final Four. Did they know they were going to get there? Or did they just have a little luck with it? But here it is, Taz once again. And a guy that's familiar to the show. John, good to see you again.
Yeah,
didn't expect to see you 2 weeks in a row.
No, man.
But here we are.
Well, I heard Taz was here, and I had to surprise my man.
Nice surprise.
This guy helped make me famous.
How did y'all meet? How did y'all meet, first of all?
Oh, I don't know, Taz, probably in the 8th grade, 7th grade.
One of his camps.
One of your camps, I came to camp.
I was a part of his camp. Forever,
that's it? So. That's how it happened.
Yeah.
So when you're recruiting a guy like this, right. I know you had Stromile, who was a top 5 player in the country as well. But what was that, 5, 6, 7 years before that when you recruited him? What's it like when you know everybody in the country wants him? There's other guys that you know you got. But, you know, when you're talking about a top player in the country, 1, 2, 3, you know, everybody's going to come in the back door. What was that like trying to recruit him?
Well, I think Stromile helped that. Local players, Louisiana players, so they could stay home and be successful.
Yeah.
And Stromile's the second pick in the NBA draft. The team was, when we took it over, we were in trouble, and we convinced Stromile to come and just set the tone. If we get you, other people may follow, and that's what kind of happened. And he had success. We showed Tasman that. And, you know, I'm going to tell you, even today, even before that, guys who grew up in Louisiana and play basketball here, play football here, There's something about that LSU and that purple and gold that's special. And you find the right collection of guys that want to do that. And I've always convinced with the number of good high school players Louisiana had had in the past and presently when we got there, if we could convince them, it could be like their AAU team that won a couple of national championships in AAU. Why don't you bring that to Baton Rouge, put LSU on your chest, and let's show the country how really good we are. And we were able to do that with these guys. Four from Baton Rouge, one from St. Martinville, this guy from Denham Springs. Lo and behold, we go to the Final Four. And I'm going to tell you a caveat there we were talking about earlier. We won the SEC that year outright. Florida finished second.
That's right.
We both
go
to the Final
Four. My bad.
And Florida wins the national championship.
Don't take that away, bro. Don't take that away, man. Don't take
the SEC.
Come on, man.
16 years.
Oh, man. Don't take that away from us.
The crazy thing is, like, when you're sitting here with all these guys, and that's the same thing. You remember Marquise Hill, who played football from De La Salle? I remember the same show you were on that I flew you in. I flew him up to Atlanta Beyond. He said, you know what? I want to go to LSU. I'm tired of seeing guys go to other schools, other states and that. He goes, I want Louisiana players to stay here. And that's what Saban did. Saban built that fence just like you're talking about. You built that fence. We all know that the state of Louisiana per capita has got the most major league players, most NBA players, and most football players. Because this small state's got a lot of talent, so if you keep them here, you can win. But what made you want to play for this dude?
Oh man, well, start off with my
But
for real though, I mean, like I said, I mean, I, you know, because Brady was a good coach, you know what I'm saying? You know, you hear your stories about him, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, he used to get on you, he held you accountable,
he
you know
held
what
you
I'm saying?
Accountable.
But that was okay though, because I needed that and I wanted that.
Right.
But I also had my brothers
that's
that
a good
he,
way to put it, you he know, held you accountable.
But I also had my brothers there too though, that trusted him as well, so I'm like, they trust him, why can't I?
Right on.
So I'm like, I'm just going to stay home, man. Also, you wanted your family to watch you play, man, and you wanted, you know, like I said, I thought the same thing he thought. You know, everybody going to go to Dukes and the North Carolinas and stuff, the normal schools normally do the bluegrass
Kentucky,
schools, Kentucky.
Right.
You know, I'm stay home. You know, we're going to put LSU on our back, and we're just going to continue to roll. But that's why I stayed home. You know what I'm saying? Also because I knew I was going to get good coaching. You know, he had a good core of assistant coaches too.
Yeah,
as
he
well.
Certainly did.
You know, a good
You're
core
right
of assistant
that.
Coaches as well. But he also had good players and like my brother. So I'm like, it was no second guessing where I wanted to go.
His mother didn't mind it either. She was able to see him play.
Yeah, she didn't
and
mind.
Even come to practice when she wanted to. Didn't bother
look,
me.
Look.
You got a ticket inside. It's time.
Oh, man, because Brady used to always let her, she's, you know, hey, come on in. You know what I'm saying? He ain't practiced too good yesterday, but he going to come on in. You know what I'm saying? But nah, but it was great, man.
His mom come up in the office. You know, she'd sit around and talk to us when she was doing her rounds. She'd visit with us. That was as close to a family atmosphere, that team, with how those players knew each other, grew up together, that you can have on the collegiate level.
I love that
in my mind.
Oh, yeah, man. He hollered at one of us, man. He hollered at one of us.
Well, he didn't seem too upset in that picture.
I didn't show any faith.
I've got a few others. I just have reluctant not to. He's definitely yelling at somebody in that
one. Hey, what are you doing? That's what are you doing? What's going on?
This is like, I'm tired
of yelling. What did you do?
What did he just do that? What did he just do? I don't know.
Let's get into the team, because you were the true freshman starter. You were a four-time first team All-State player in high school. That doesn't happen very often. I mean, as a freshman, you're first team All-State. But you go to LSU, you have Garrett Temple, who I believe was a redshirt freshman, right? He was a guard. You played 2-3, you know, maybe a little 4 as well. You're versatile. But then you had Tyrus Thomas, who kind of blew up, you know, another Baton Rouge kid. These are all Baton Rouge guys right here. Denham, I'm going to consider that
another redshirt freshman.
Another redshirt freshman. And then you had, obviously, Daryl Mitchell and Darnell Lazar were upperclassmen.
Yep.
Daryl, I believe, was probably one of the leaders of the team. Darnell, Baton Rouge guy as well. Daryl from St. Martinville. And Glenn Big Baby Davis, one of the big – another guy that came on that show in Atlanta. I mean, one of the biggest personalities ever. Obviously, a McDonald's All-American, top 10 player in the country coming out of high school. Could have played football and done just as well. That's your main core. And you have Magnum Roll and all the other guys. And I know they played their roles. But this group is what was talked about. And you'd mentioned it for a second in the last segment, but I want to get into it more now, because you talked about how y'all bonded after Katrina, during Katrina, but you guys knew each other for a while. When did you realize that this might be something special?
Oh, man, I realized it could have been something special in the summer workouts, man, how hard we was
before
working.
Before,
I didn't know how we was going to go to the Final Four,
but I knew
we had a chance to be good because we was already good on the national level anyway.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Well, as far as the AAU team.
Sure.
So, but, you know, our summer workouts, Coach Brady used to put us through, and we gave it our all. Like, John Treloar used to have us going through a lot of our workouts. We used to throw up and stuff like that, but we used to throw up, but we used to come back to the court. That's how I knew. It was little things like that I knew, okay, we got the basketball savvy. Okay, we want to be
but
good.
Three you guys as a freshman, though, that's the thing that kind of blew me away because you guys did it so fast.
Right, the thing about it is we matured real fast.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Even though we were freshmen, we had a level of maturity because, like I said, we've been in the trenches with each other for a long time, playing against each other and also playing with each other. So, you know, it was when Coach Brady got us, it was like a breath of fresh air for him, though. You know what I'm saying? Because he didn't have to make me, hey, get up and work. Hey, play hard. Hey, go hard. He didn't have to tell me that.
Right.
I did it anyway. You know?
They already knew each other. Their families, they'd been through stuff together with AAU, they knew of each other playing in high school.
And AAU does, you're with them all the time in the summers, you're all over, that makes sense.
And it was a unique thing to really happen. And our preseason schedule was really tough. We played Connecticut, we played Cincinnati, we played Ohio State. We had a preseason schedule that was pretty challenging. In fact, we started SEC play at 8-5.
Yeah.
Right.
And our first SEC game was at Arkansas.
Yeah.
And we went there and we were down one or two at the half. Then we came out the second half and walked out of there with a 10-12 point victory. And I knew then when we went into that environment with 18,000 and were able to clip them, coming back on that plane, I said, barring injury, this team could be pretty good. And then we rolled off 8 or 9 straight wins and, rest is history kind of. Well, one close game. Now, I've always said the difference in a successful season and a special season is your ability to win close games.
Absolutely.
And we only lost one close game that whole year. We popped everybody when it came down the last 2 or 3 minutes.
You learned how to win. I mean, that first team you had. I mean, you were outmanned by almost everybody you played, but you played everybody tight, but y'all weren't there ready to win
yet. That's where Tasman alludes to the camaraderie and the feeling they had for one another.
Right, that special thing
where no distractions. It was a family. And each player picked the other player up when it wasn't going quite well. And then they also, thank the good Lord, they understood me. They didn't.
Right.
They understood the message. Maybe not the messenger, but they understood.
Oh, I get it.
We understood the message, not the delivery.
You knew he meant well.
Not the delivery. We knew he meant well because if he stopped talking, they always say, if a coach stopped talking to you, if he stopped talking to me, that means you're done.
You know
what I'm saying? So if he's yelling at you and you're getting his face red and stuff like that, it's okay. It's good.
It's good. The execution, my man. But it worked. It worked. Let's talk about him for a second because I just remember I've had everybody from Peyton Manning to LeBron James on that show in Atlanta. And you get to meet all the people in the office, and without even a close second, everybody's like, man, that big baby was the most fun guy they've ever been around, period. And what was he like as a teammate and then a guy that played for you?
I actually just talked to Big Fella yesterday, man. You know, we talked it up, but he was one of a kind, man.
He was one of a kind, man.
It's to the point where I was kind of the only one that really can control him. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
As far as he's listening to me, and it's a respect mode, not nothing scared, but I wasn't backing down.
Y'all on a plane together, and you were like 10th grade or 9th grade. He's 1 year older than you, right?
Yeah, he's one year older than me.
Whatever it was, one of y'all was in 8th grade or 9th grade, and the other was like a sophomore.
Right.
I just remember y'all go back that far, man. And then, but you're younger, and he still respects you like that.
Yeah, man. And then, with him, man, you know what you're going to get from him. You know, he might pout a little bit. That's why we call him Big Baby a little bit.
Yeah,
you know, he might pout a little bit, pout around, but you had to get to him, and once you got to him, it was over with. You know what I'm saying? But, I mean, playing with him was great. It was awesome. Man. It was love to have a solid 5, man. Man, you know what I'm saying? That if you get it to him, he's going to make something happen. He's going to get fouled, or he's going to score the ball.
Great hands, great feet.
He was real dependable.
300 pounds. I mean, but he had the – I mean, I remember seeing at the SEC tournament with – Fred Hoiberg was there, and Chris Grant, who was a scout with the Hawks, he goes, this guy needs to wear a helmet. and play football. Somebody needs to get in his head. And he would have been phenomenal, but I said, dude, this guy loves basketball, and he's going to be in the, he says he's not going to be in the NBA. I said, he's going to the NBA.
We had this coach at LSU, y'all may have heard of him, named Nick Saban, and he tried to recruit. He tried to recruit for him to play football.
And I saw a video of him, man.
He didn't. He did play high school football for what, a year or two?
Yeah, he played for a year or two.
Dude, I'm telling you, he picked up ball. I thought the video was sped up, and it's still this day. I'm not sure if it wasn't, but he looked so fast. I was like, and it's so weird to see a guy that big running that fast.
One thing about Big Fella, man, I call him Big Fella. One thing about Big Fella, he was nimble.
Nimble.
He was big, small ankles, big calf muscle, great feet, great body movement, great. You know what I'm saying? He was the most nimble person at 300 pounds that I can never see in my life.
And larger than life personality, he was just so much fun to be around.
And Scott, he knew how to play.
Yes.
All of these guys knew how to play. If there was something going on in the game and I needed to change it, I could draw something on the board at a timeout. And these guys were students of the game. They could carry it into the game, something we haven't even really worked on. Glenn could really, he could really, Tasman understood, Daryl Mitchell understood the game. So that was one thing that was also special about this collection of guys.
Well, let's talk about the run, because I don't want to run out of time before we get to it. Let's start quickly about the first game, because I was at all the games. Jacksonville, first round of the NCAA tournament, you played this guy that led the nation in scoring, Steve Burt with Iona. We're like, okay, this is going to be cake. We're going to get through this one, probably play Syracuse in game two, right? We're thinking that's going to be the case. Well, this was a tight first game. Iona was balling, but y'all ended up winning that. Do you have any doubt y'all going to come out on top? Because I did for a little while.
That.
I did for a little bit.
As a coach, I always have doubts. You know, I'm never convinced.
That's Burt right there that left.
Look, one thing about Coach Brady, we couldn't really be laxed around him.
Right.
Because he was always on the edge about, hey, y'all better get right. You know what I'm saying? This team can beat y'all, you know?
Right.
But just basically doing what a coach is supposed to do. Because I find myself doing that right now with our players.
It's a 4-13 matchup.
We took them the first half. We took them for granted. You know what I'm saying? They came out and gave us a punch. And we, like, it's halftime with Coach Brady. Said Coach Brady got us right. He gave us all speech, and we were like, hey, yo, we got to get it together, man.
Yeah.
We got to get it together. And we end up coming out. We, how much we beat them by?
We scored them 18 the second 18, half, beat them like 16 or something.
Yeah, second half was it. Yeah. Let's go to the second game, because we thought it was going to be Syracuse, 4-5 matchup. Didn't happen, Tennessee State tournament. Texas A&M, pre-SEC Texas A&M, they're over in the Big 12 at this point. You get them, they got AC Law, who's a baller, and this came down the wire. Let's get to this part real quick, because down two, I don't know, 6 seconds. I don't know how much time was on the clock. I just remember being in the crowd, like eight rows behind the bench, and I remember Daryl Mitchell gets the ball. I'm like, please just get two to tie this game. Please just go to overtime. And he puts this shot up, and I just remember thinking, no, yes! And he makes the three, but that wasn't his first three-pointer that he beat teams with this year, was it?
No, we'd won three games at the buzzer that year, and Daryl had hit all three shots at the end. So the play that we ran was called special.
Right.
We just put it in about a week or 10 days before it.
Right.
And so it got Daryl Mitchell the ball. And I didn't try to overcoach it and say, we need a two, we're going to drive it. I just wanted to get Daryl the ball. We got Daryl the ball. He made the decision to shoot the three, which I was going to live or die with, or drive it, whatever he chose to do. But we had a player who had been in that situation.
A senior.
Let him decide it. We go with him. And he makes
it's one of the greatest shots in LSU basketball history.
No question about it.
I'll put up there with Anthony Wilson's shot to go to the Sweet 16 in 86.
Yeah.
But I'm going to say this. You need to send a bouquet of flowers to this man, because millions more people know who John Brady is because of that one shot. Because you, without that shot, you don't get the chance to beat Duke. Well, you don't get the chance to beat Texas to go to the final.
It changed lives. That one shot changed my life. It changed Garrett Temple's life. He got to go guard J.J. Redick. Garrett's always known for that.
Yeah.
I mean,
It changed lives. That
I'm
one
say this,
shot.
Billy Donovan.
And I'm not trying to
nobody
oversimplify.
Nobody knows who Rick Pitino is. I'll say this all day. If Billy Donovan doesn't hit a similar shot to go to the Final Four, when Providence went to the Final Four in New Orleans, you know, that year it was Syracuse and Indiana won it in 87. But without that shot, man, he doesn't get the next job with the Knicks. I mean, he doesn't go to Kentucky. It's crazy how life is, man.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
But let's go to this next game, because to me, this is the greatest game in LSU basketball history. Duke comes in. I was an agent at the time. I'm recruiting J.J. I knew his family. He's a leading scorer. I was there when he got he beat Johnny Dawkins' record for most points in Duke history. He was Duke basketball. This dude was averaging 27 a game. You guys held him to like 11 or even less. I don't know what it was. And it was 3 for 18 from the field.
It was nine.
It was nine. Whatever it was, it was like 20 below his average. Yeah. And he was crying after the game. But this to me, and I know you still had to beat Texas to go to the Final Four, but this to me was everything. I mean, as a player, I want you to talk about it because I was in Atlanta where I was living at the time. It was in the Georgia Dome, but you talk about it.
Well, Coach Treloar, you know, he was our defensive guy, you know, because Brady had certain guys. He was our offensive guy. Coach Treloar was our defensive mastermind. And so what happened was, you know, he appointed us. He used to appoint us players. Like, he used to put us account of, hey, if this guy get this amount of points, then you're the reason why we lost the game. Right. You know what I mean? So basically, we watched a lot of film, and Garrett watched a lot of film. We knew Garrett can guard him because all J.J. Redick wanted to do is go around the screens. And Garrett can run all
day. But a freshman against you know a senior, saying? I mean.
Oh, man, yeah,
just made it. Garrett's still in the NBA, by the way.
And because of that.
Because of that.
Because of that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, because, you know, so.
Sheldon
so.
Williams, the other guy in that picture, was the sixth pick of the draft because I know that was a bust because it was Atlanta. Right. And I was covering the Hawks.
Well, Duke was number one in the country.
Yeah.
The number one overall seed. Had this guy named Krzyzewski coaching.
Yeah.
So to be able to win that game, and what J.J. did in practice, we won him out. We piggybacked him off of every screen, and the last screener would come out and help. The last screener, if he slipped to the basket and they made a basket or two, we didn't really care. Help would absorb that. Yeah. But we just won him out, and the last screener would jump, and we just made him catch it farther out than he wanted to.
Right, right.
And the overall thing is J.J.'s 3 for 18 or whatever the final number was. Duke scored 54 points.
That's crazy.
And you look back at Mike Krzyzewski and all the games he's coached. When has Duke scored 54 points?
Well, by the way, what's your record against Coach K history?
1-0, and I tell my
you're 1-0 against Coach K.
I tell my good coaching friends, particularly Tim Florida, Kermit Davis, that you know anytime they need me to give a clinic, just let me know. I beat Coach K.
And there you go, 61-54. The tears were there. I don't have a ton of time, but I want to talk about Texas because people forget Texas. LaMarcus Aldridge, big time all-star player in the NBA. PJ Tucker still playing the league.
Yeah, great player.
Luby Gibson.
Yeah, Daniel.
You know, he was in the NBA Finals quickly, right? This team was good. Rick Barnes will probably tell you this is probably one of his biggest, if not biggest, loss in his career.
The best
as well.
Team I think he ever coached.
And that there it is in there. Yeah. Everybody's making some waves there. That's in the dome right there, the regional. But getting that and then knowing you're going to the Final Four, and we won't talk about the Final Four.
I mean, Tasman hit the first bucket in overtime.
Look at that. Tyrus, by the way, made millions in Atlanta.
Oh, yeah.
Tyrus made millions in Atlanta. All of a sudden, he's like going to be a late first round. He's the fourth pick of the draft.
Right,
Let me ask Tasman something. What's your favorite zone play we ran? What was it called?
C. Coach Brady, I was the screener. Hey, I was excited because I know the roof is about to blow up off the building.
Right,
you know what I'm saying?
Dunking.
It was lob dunking. Throw it up in the lob dunking. I go screen.
Uh-huh.
It, like it's for me, but it's not really for me. I'm supposed to just go out to the
You're
corner.
But
Tyrus kind of stiff up a little bit off the block, and then I kind of back screen his man. And Darren Mitchell dribbles over to the seven, then throw it up, and
we played Tennessee.
There it is, right there.
That's it right there.
We played Tennessee this year, and after the game, Rick Barnes walked by me. He says, "Coach, we still run that play. Run it here in Tennessee."
Hey, man, we run it.
Well, they got shots here. I remember y'all running into the stands. I was like on the 8th row, and the boas. Big Baby had a boa. I know y'all were just so excited.
Oh,
it was like one of the great moments of my entire
Louisiana came out in Atlanta.
Dude, it was phenomenal. The night that was the best night.
Oh.
Look at that. Good memories, huh? All right, you got on this ball. I mean, this has been the only Dale Brown on this ball, but John, dude, you're the next Hall of Famer. By the way, this is a Louisiana High School Hall of Famer. He's going to be in all the Hall of Famers. Both these guys will be in the Louisiana Sports Hall of not just high school, but Hall of Fame before it's all said and done, and LSU as well. But, man, it's been a pleasure. I love you guys both. Dude, I've known you
Thanks for having me, man.
It's crazy. And then, John, this is special, and basketball's about to start, and he's – I love that you're calling games, still at LSU doing your thing and loving it, and then you're coaching, man. It's gonna be fun.
That's great. Yeah.
Purple and gold. Any parting comments here, real quick? No.
Well, I'm glad they hired this man right here. Warms my heart to see him on that LSU bench as a coach.
I mean, you're LSU, dude.
I appreciate him. I appreciate him as well, man.
All right, man. All right, that was great. Now we're gonna switch gears. Hey, we gotta talk LSU football. How about this team? Everybody left them for dead. What a difference 2 weeks make. They go on the road, they skunk Florida pretty badly, and then they come home. Ole Miss is number 7 in the country. What do? They go 17-3. They're down. They outscore them 42-3 the rest of the way. beat them 45-20. But Alabama's coming up this week. We're going to talk Tigers, Saints, Tulane, and, of course, the Pels. Coming up next right here on Primetime Sports. Thanks, guys.
Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sport. How much fun was that with John Brady and Taz Mitchell? What two great guys. But we're going to move forward right now. You know what I've always done? Guys that are new and young, I always try to give them a chance. We just had Jack on Collada not long ago. I've had guys like when Jake Madison was just kind of getting started and I was doing ESPN Radio. I love bringing these guys in. Well, today's going to be no different. There's a guy I met 2 years ago, and now he's working here at WLAE. He's a graduate of Southeastern. Just 2 years out of college, but this dude knows his sports, and he wants to be on air one day. He started here as an intern. Now he's a production assistant. He's moving up rapidly. People love him here, but his name is Logan Graffia, and here he is for the first time on Primetime Sports. We're here to talk some local sports. How you been, Logan?
Been good, actually. And before we get started, I just want to say this. Surprise, Pop. I want to just say happy birthday, and I hope you like this present.
Happy birthday, Boa. His dad did not know that he was going to be on today. I love the surprise. It is his 57th birthday. What a great year. That's also the number you wore when you played football.
Yes, I wore 57, 56, and 51. I was one number away from wearing 53 to get the whole Dome Patrol.
That's right.
I love the Dome Patrol.
So you left out what, Vaughn Johnson?
I left out Vaughn Johnson.
Got, that's Sam Mills, 51. Obviously, you know Ricky Jackson, 57, and the great Pat Swilling, 58.
Yes.
Hey, moving forward, you went to Southeastern, and you were in broadcast journalism, communications, that kind of thing, right? And you were at the Southeastern TV station. What was that like when you were in college?
Well, I mean, it was an experience. I was really getting schooled. You know how they say when you're a rookie, you get schooled by a lot of vets?
Sure.
That's what it was like.
I love this pick, dude. I love the chops. That's a good look.
Thank you. It really was a fun experience. I made a lot of great friends there. I mean, two of which I talk to every day.
Right.
And it was a really nice experience.
So you've done it all in this business. What I love is that guys that come up don't just get on air right away. I mean, you got to work. You got to work at it. You got to do some camera, man. You got to work behind the scenes and the thing. And now you have a credential to Saints games. As a kid growing up, this has got to be awesome for you, right?
It was. I mean, when I went there, I mean, on the outside, I was all calm, cool, and collected. But
right.
On the inside, I was so emotional because I'm like, man, I'm really standing on the turf of the Superdome. I'm getting to be so close to the team that I've been watching games with my dad since I was like, I have recollection of watching when I was 3 years old.
We all are a fan of somewhere. You wouldn't be in sports, right? I mean, because that's why I love Scott Van Pelt, because people give him a hard time because he openly cheers for Maryland because he went to Maryland. He's from D.C., so he openly cheers for those teams. I love it. It's been 30 years I've been in this business, and I still get excited when I go down on the field, go to the court, go in the locker room. It's still great. It's fun, and I love that you're just getting your chance right now.
Man, it was really an experience, and I'll never forget it. That picture that you see, I actually have it framed in my house.
The Bobby Hebert?
No, the one that you see right here.
Oh, this one here. Nice, nice.
I got that one framed, and I gave it to my parents. I even took a piece of the turf from the Superdome, and it's in the frame with it, too. So it's just going to be a day I'll never forget.
Well, speaking of the Saints, let's go there because we got to talk about this team right now. A lot of people left them for dead. They were 2-5. And then they come out and shut out the Raiders. We know the Raiders aren't the Chiefs or anything, but the Raiders were one of these teams that was supposed to be good, like the Saints were supposed to be good before the season. So this was kind of a game that both teams really had to win, and the Saints came out, not just one, but they made a statement, 24-0.
I was pleasantly surprised how we shut down the Raiders 24-0 because the past 3 weeks, Josh Jacobs was averaging over 100 yards a game.
He was unbelievable.
And the Saints defense has been giving up 100-yard rushers for the past 3 weeks. So.
Which is unlike them. In the past, they just didn't do that ever. You know?
They really haven't. And also the whole Devontae Adams, of all people, to just 3 yards in one catch. Alante Taylor had his work cut out for him, and he did
the rookie quarterback.
The rookie. He had his work cut out for him, and he did a fantastic job. And I guess
That leaves a dilemma, right? Because you have obviously the great rookie from last year who's been out. I mean, he got played, and you got Lattimore coming back. I mean, what are you going to do with starting? You're going to keep Alante Taylor? How do you take him out of the lineup?
You probably going to have to use him in a CD Deuce role.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't take him off the field because you didn't take CD Deuce off the field. And you're going to have Marshawn, Paulson, and Alante all on the field at the same time because once you get Marshawn back, I think the secondary will be a lot stronger. It's looking like it's getting stronger. It got strong this game alone.
Playmakers matter, dude. And I'm going to say this. They put the ball in the hands of their best playmaker in this game. You saw the touches. You saw the 10 targets, 9 catches. two touchdown receptions for Alvin Kamara, AK-41. He got all three touchdowns, one on the ground. How important is it to have him, and how important would it be? We don't know what's going on with Mike Thomas, but when you got the two of the best offensive players in their prime in the league, you got to get them the ball. But what do you think about this moving forward, and can they keep getting the ball in the guys that need the ball in their hands?
Now, the past couple weeks, the fans have also been saying you got to get the ball to Alvin Kamara and even Taysom Hill.
Right.
Even though Michael Thomas is out, he will be a factor when he comes back. But you have to keep the ball in the hands of your playmakers because that's how you win games.
Exactly.
There's a reason why the offense has been scoring over 30 points a game since they put Andy Dalton in.
Right.
They went back to what they've been doing since 06 and what they've been killing teams with since 06. The short intermediate game.
Right.
Get it to your running back on the Texas route.
Right.
Or give it to Taysom Hill on a read option. Let him do quarterback power.
Yes.
DBs do not want to tackle.
You preach to the choir right here. Taysom Hill needs the ball in his hands, man. I don't necessarily want him to be a quarterback, but he's got to
especially
be a weapon.
In the red zone.
You have a weapon there, and they obviously utilize him a lot more in this game. Hey, moving forward, going forward, the Saints, they're now 3-5. They happen to be lucky this year because the NFC South has become the old NFC East. 500 might win it for you. The Saints still have a chance to make this somewhat special. If they can get a streak of wins, they've done it before, they've won a bunch of games in a row, you get healthier, do they have a chance not only to make the playoffs, they're only a game behind the Falcons, and I don't think the Falcons are scaring anybody, because the Bucs are in turmoil too. They're 3-5 as well. But going forward, realistically, can this team do some damage?
I mean, it all matters on health to start off, and I think if they could just stop the turnovers, which that's Raiders game, they
zero turnovers,
right. And you win the game.
Well, listen, I mean, I saw, one of the Jason Kelce last night. He said they're plus 14 in turnovers, and they're 7-0. It matters, right?
It matters.
And the Saints were the worst in margin. We got to move forward to college because I want to get them all in. Let's start with the LSU Tigers. I mean, this team was another team left for dead, much like the Saints just were. And then all of a sudden they go on the road and beat a Florida team, and they beat them handily. Now, this team has a knack for getting down early. They did it again pretty much every game. They did it again in the surprise win. I think it wasn't a surprise that they won, but the fashion they beat Ole Miss 2 weeks ago, being down 17-3, you're like, oh, no, not again. And all of a sudden they come back and outscoring 42-3 the rest of the way to win 45-20. This team's got Bama coming up, and they're a little less than a two-touchdown underdog. Some crazy things happen under the lights at LSU. I've been to many games where people think they have no chance. Can they beat this Bama team? Because both have had a bye week. Neither are going to sneak up on each other. But do they have a chance in this game?
I will say they have a chance. Whether they win or lose, I can't say. But I just think it's going to be a really close game because I think LSU is starting to gel
right
at the right time.
Right.
And they got the right coach for this.
Right.
The second half adjustments they've had in the past two games where they've been down.
Right. It's been remarkable. It's
especially
been remarkable.
Against Ole Miss. I mean, no one thought we was going to beat the number 7 team in the country. Well, I was telling my dad, I said, look, we're going to beat Ole Miss. And he thought I was crazy. I said, no, we're going to beat Ole Miss today. We're going to surprise people.
And they did. I'm going to say this. Somebody asked me yesterday what the percentage chance that you – and I just threw it out. I said 22% chance LSU wins. And I thought that might even be high. But I really do think they can win. And then I saw something like last night where they said LSU's got a 24% chance. So the people that know they have a shot. So who knows what's going to happen. Let's go to Tulane. I'd be remiss to leave them out because, listen, the Green Wave are doing something they haven't done since 1998. They're ranked. And not even just the top 25 now. Now they've moved up to the top 20. You know you got something special when you don't even play and they respect you enough to move you up three slots. So they're 19 in one poll, 21 in the other. That's my man Willie Fritz. You gotta love what the Wave has done. They were 2-10 last season. They turned around with that guy leading the charge, Michael Pratt.
Well, I mean, you gotta tip your hat off to Coach Fritz. He made a lot of staffing changes during the offseason, and it's worked out tremendously. He gets a former D2 head coach comes in and be the offensive coordinator.
Yes.
The offense is looking the best it's had since 1998 with Sean King. So gotta tip my hat off to Willie Fritz and just the incredible coaching job he's done. Michael Pratt. Been watching him play. This man takes a pound in and just keeps on coming.
I think he's going to play on Sundays. I really do. I'm not saying he's going to start, but I think he's going to be in a jersey on Sundays, and who knows. And congrats to them as well. They got UCF, a big one this week. And the New Orleans Pelicans, I can't leave it out. I know this is a shorter segment than I want it to be, but the Pelicans got even my Friends in Atlanta are calling me and said, man, we are hooked on the Pels now. That is a true story for Atlanta people to root for a New Orleans team. And this is a fact. That guy right there, Willie Green, has got them rolling. Tell me what you think about this 4-2 New Orleans Pelican team.
Well, I am actually not surprised. Going into the season, yeah. I had them pegged as a 4 seed in the Western Conference. And I said, we might make it all the way to the Western Conference Finals. We have the roster to do it. CJ, B.I., Zion, Jonas Valanciunas, Herb. We have one of the top five, probably starting fives in the NBA.
And the bench is nice, too, man.
You got to talk about the second line.
Right.
The second line is just tremendous. The second line alone could go probably be a starting five for probably even the Lakers right now.
Oh, that's right. They got the Lakers, and, boy, do we want this victory tomorrow. Dude, this has been phenomenal. We're going to give you back. I love giving people a shot, and this guy knows his stuff, too. Congrats, Logan. Hey, Bubba, happy birthday. Happy birthday. This is a good choice. And here's a Task performance shirt. I know you love black. You're wearing it right now, so I got you a black one.
It's beautiful.
Congratulations, man. I appreciate you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. I really appreciate it.
He's going to be back. We're going to have him back. I love him. Logan Graffia right there. He's going to be one of my guys. When we talk local sports, the guy knows it. A lot of people to thank, man. Will Hill does an amazing job right here. Tommy, thank you so much today. Hope you're having fun on vacation, Alex. And, of course, Ron and Jim Dotson, Ron Yeager as well. Hey, so WLE, we're coming back next week. How about Taz Mitchell? How much fun was he? And how much fun was John Brady? That was all kind of fun. Go LSU, go Saints, go Tulane, go Pels. Let's get it done right here on Primetime Sports. See you next week.